Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I have with me an article taken from the Asian Times. It reads, Aisha was only 19 when she was sent to London from Pakistan to marry an older British-born Asian male she had never met. 4 years later, she finds herself isolated, hurt, angry, but safe in a woman's refuge after fleeing an abusive marriage she never consented to. When Aisha landed in West London in 1995, she couldn't speak English and wasn't clear what was expected of her. Suddenly, she found herself married to Nadine and living in a house along with his mother-in-law. Within a few weeks, her husband found her work in a local factory with firm instructions to come straight home afterwards. Every week, her wages were snatched away from her and she was just left with enough to catch a bus to and from work. And at weekends, she was kept a virtual prisoner in her home. Although she strongly wished to learn English, she was refused permission to take any classes. Whenever she misbehaved, she was beaten by her husband and mother-in-law. Occasionally, they would jump on her at the same time. Household items such as brooms and wooden spoons were some of the weapons used, leaving large dark bruises and throbbing welts all over her body. Distress she confided in a female Asian colleague at work, but Aisha was treading on dangerous ground as a few of her husband's friends were based at the factory. Fearful of retaliation, they always talked in secret. Aisha's colleague agreed to help her run away by getting a message to Aisha's family in Pakistan, and it continues and continues, and I'm sure you've heard many of these before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how best this story is. But the issue that caught everybody's attention in the last few months and made the headlines, the newspapers, the TV, the chat shows, the radio, was the issue of forced marriages. And those that are always looking for an opportunity to have a go at Islam, they began to relate this as being an Islamic problem. Their aim and objective? Propaganda against Islam? And to create hatred amongst the masses for Islam, Muslim and non-Muslim alike. That forced marriage is a teaching of Islam. Islam is a religion which gives no rights to women. I have come here to make it clear that the issue of forced marriage, yes, it exists within our society, but it's not an Islamic problem. It is not what Islam teaches. It is a cultural problem. And the difference between culture and Islam is the difference between, like the difference between the heaven and the earth. And what our Islam has to offer with regards to marriage, no other religion, no other way of life offers what Allah and our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered us in Islam. To get a true picture of what Islam has to offer, you will have to know what was rife in society before Islam came, so that you can compare the two. The hadith in Sahih Bukhari, narrated by our mother Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says that there were four types of marriage in the days of ignorance. فَنِكَاحٌ مِنْهَا كَنِكَاحِ النَّاسِ الْيَوْمِ. A marriage similar to the marriage that we have nowadays. A man would approach another man and he would ask for his daughter's hand or sister's hand in marriage, or any of those he was in charge of. He would give dowry, mahar, and he would marry her. This is the first type of marriage. She says the second type of marriage was one in which a man would say to his wife after she had become clean from her period, "Ke'arsili ila fulan fastabdi'i min," that send for so and so and go have sexual relations with this person. And the husband himself would stay away from his wife within this period, and he would not touch her till she had become pregnant from the second man and her pregnancy became evident. Once her pregnancy became evident, if he wished and desired to go to her, he would do so. And the reason they would do this, the hadith states, وَإِنَّمَا يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ رَغْبَةً فِي نَجَابَةِ الْوَلَدِ. The reason he will let his wife commit adultery with another man, it is adultery. The reason he will let his wife commit adultery with another man is so that they have a child of a noble breed. And this type of nikah, our mother Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha say, was called nikahul istibda. The third type of marriage was one in which a group of men, less than 10, would come upon a woman, and each and every one of them would have sexual relations with this woman. When she became pregnant and delivered a child, and a few nights passed, she would call all these men. And not one would be able to refuse to come. She would call these men and she would address them. قَدْ أَرَفْتُمُ الَّذِي كَانَ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ. You know what you have done. And now I have given birth to a child, and it is your child, or so and so. Out of the 10 men, she would name any one of them. Whether this child belonged to this man or not, she would name any one of them, and this person who she has named would have to take this child. And he would not be able to refuse the child. This was the third type of marriage. The fourth type of marriage was one in which men would come, a group of men would come to a woman, and she would not refuse any man that came to her, and these were considered as bad women of that time. Now, and they would have signs on their doors, flags as signs on their doors for this type of business. Now, when one of these women became pregnant, they would call the qa'if, person skilled in recognizing the likeness of a child to his father. They would call the qa'if, and these qa'if would decide who this child belongs to. They would look at all the different men that came upon her, and then they would decide that this child belongs to this person, and he would have to take the child, and he could not refuse him. So these were the four different types of marriage that our mother Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha has mentioned in this hadith. If we look at the Quran deeply and look at other hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will find many different types of marriage that were rife in society at the time. There was called a marriage called shighar, a marriage in which a man would marry the daughter or sister of another man on the condition that that second man married his daughter or sister. There was no dowry mentioned in between. This was nikah shighar. There was a marriage called maqt, and the child born from this marriage was called maqti. What would happen in this marriage was that a man would marry his father's wife after his death. He would marry his stepmother. They did not restrict themselves to a certain number. They married 5, 10, 15, 20. If you open Tirmizi Sharif, you will find the hadith that when Ghailan ibn Salama al-Thaqafi embraced Islam, his 10 wives which he had married in the days of ignorance embraced Islam with him. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam ordered him to only choose 4 from amongst them. Woman had no right whatsoever, especially with regards to marriage in the days of ignorance. Marriage, they considered marriage as a transaction, just like any other transaction. Just like fruit and veg was sold in the market. Women were sold. Her wali would decide where she married without consulting her and without giving her a choice. And the money that he received for this woman, he himself would keep. In some societies, such was the situation that everything the woman possessed, gold, silver, furniture, was not hers. It belonged to her husband. Even the wedding gifts she received, every penny she earned as a wife did not belong to her, it belonged to her husband. And the only thing she was entitled to as a wife was her dowry, and that was only when her husband died or at the time of divorce. The Arabs had another custom. When they traveled, what they would do was they would tie a string to one of the branches of a tree, and they would travel. When they returned, they would come to this very tree and look at the string. If the string was exactly like they left it, they would believe that their wife has remained faithful and loyal in their absence, and she hasn't committed a sin. And for whatever reason, if the string was not as they left it, or was broken untied, their mentality was such that they believed that in their absence, their wife has betrayed them, has committed a sin, has committed adultery. They would harass them by divorcing them 50-100 times. They would divorce them, and the women would have to sit in iddah, a period of waiting. Now, just about when this period of waiting came to an end, they would revoke. They would divorce them again. The wife would have to sit in iddah again. Just as the iddah is coming to an end, they would revoke. They would divorce, they would revoke, and this is how they would harass and tease their wives. So this is what was rife in the days of ignorance before Islam came. This was the mentality of the Arabs. These were their ways, and these were their customs. And it was in this atmosphere Islam came. Now, how does Islam go about changing mentality such as this? Culture, ways and practices which are nothing but evil. Islam first explained to them that marriage is not a transaction, and a woman is not a good or commodity which can be bought and sold at a price the wali determines and keeps. The act of marriage is a sacred thing, ordained by Allah Himself and practiced by His messengers. It's a form of worship. Just like when you stand and pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, namaz is a form of worship, zakat is a form of worship, fasting is a form of worship, going to hajj is a form of worship, giving sadaqah is a form of worship. Islam explained to these people and to people to come to the end of time that marriage is also a form of worship. Aqaf ibn Wada' came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked him, Alaka zawjatun ya Aqaf? O Aqaf, are you married? He replied, no. Wala jariyatun? Do you not have a slave girl? Here again, he replied, no. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, Wa anta sahihun musiran? Yet you have the ability to marry. You can afford the mahar, you are rich. And you are able, you are healthy. He replied, Na'am, alhamdulillah. By Allah, yes. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, Fa anta izan min ikhwani shayateen. Then you are from amongst the shayateen's brothers. إن كنت من رهبان النصارى فالحق بهم. If you are from amongst the Christian police who do not believe in marrying, then go stay with them. وإن كنت منا. If you are from amongst the Muslims. If you are from amongst the true Muslims, if you are from amongst us. فصنع كما نصنع. Then do as we do. إن من سنة النكاح. To marry is from amongst our ways. The worst from amongst you is he who can marry, who has the ability to marry, who can afford to marry, and he does not marry. The worst from amongst your dead are those who left this world that had the ability to marry. They could afford to marry. They were healthy, and they left this world not marrying. The hadith in Sahih Muslim. A group of three men came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's wife's houses, asking about Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's worship. When they were informed about Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's worship, they regarded their worship to be insufficient. And they said, وَأَيْنَ نَحْنُ مِنَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Where do we compare with Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام؟ قَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Allah has forgiven all his sins for him. Where do we compare with Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام؟ And they promised, one promised, that he will stay awake during the night. And he will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every night. And he will not go to sleep. And the second, أَنَا أَصُومُ الدَّهْرَ وَلَا أُفْتِرْ. That I will fast, and I will fast every day, and I will not break my fast. And the third, أَعْتَزِلُ النِّسَاءَ لَا أَتَزَوَّجْ أَبَدًا. I will stay away from women as if there's something evil, and I will never marry. When Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام came and he was informed what these people said, he called these people and said, أَنْتُمُ الَّذِينَ كُلْتُمْ كَذَا وَكَذَا. Are you the ones that said so and so thing? Such and such a thing? إِنِّي لَأَخْشَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ وَأَتْقَاكُمْ لَهُ وَأَصُومُ وَأُفْتِرْ وَأُصَلِّ وَأَرْكُدْ وَأَتَزَوَّجُ النِّسَةِ. I am more submissive to Allah than you, and I fear Him more than you do. But I fast, and I break my fast. I pray during the night, and I also sleep. And I do not stay away from women. I've also married women. I marry women. The hadith yet again in Sahih Muslim. A group of Sahaba came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and listen what they said to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahu Akbar, they said, Ya Rasulullah, Zahaba Ahl al-Dusuri bil Ujur. Look at the concern of the Sahaba. He said, Ya Rasulullah, Zahaba Ahl al-Dusuri bil Ujur, that the rich men have taken all the sawab. This is the concern. That the rich men have taken all the sawab and the ajr. Why? Yusalluna kama nusalli. When Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, they also pray and we pray. That is equal. وَيَسُومُون كَمَا نَسُوم. They fast, we fast. We are equal. وَيَتَصَدَّقُونَ بِفُضُولِ أَمْوَالِهِمْ وَنَبِي صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ. They have surpassed us. Why? Because Allah has given them wealth. And they're able to donate. They're able to give sadaqah. And because we have no wealth, وَنَبِي صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ, we are unable to give sadaqah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what shall we do? They have taken all the ajr, they have taken all the thawab and reward. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, أَوَلَيْسَ كَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مَا تَصَدَّقُونَ. Hasn't Allah given you such a thing? If you do this thing, then you also will receive the reward of sadaqah. إِنَّ بِكُلِّ تَصْبِحَةٍ صَدَقَةٌ وَكُلِّ تَكْبِيرَةٍ صَدَقَةٌ وَكُلِّ تَحْمِيدَةٍ صَدَقَةٌ وَكُلِّ تَهْلِيلَةٍ صَدَقَةٌ وَأَمْرٌ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ صَدَقَةٌ وَنَحْيٌ أَنْ مُنْكَرٍ صَدَقَةٌ وَفِي بُضِي أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةٌ. Every time you say Alhamdulillah, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. Every time you say Subhanallah, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. Every time you say Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. You see somebody doing bad and you tell him not to do this, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. You tell your friend to do something good, you call him towards prayer, you teach him to do good, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. To the extent, وَفِي بُضِ أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةٌ. In the eyes of Allah, you come to your wife and you fulfill your need and desire, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. The Sahaba was surprised. And they asked, Ya Rasulullah, أَيَأْتِ أَحَدُنَا شَهْوَتَهُ وَيَكُونَ لَهُ فِيهَا أَجْرٌ. O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of us comes to his wife and he fulfills his need and desire, and the Almighty will reward him for this. He will give him the reward of sadaqah. They could not comprehend. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam explained, tell me, if he was to do it the haram way, if he was to fulfill his need and desire with somebody other than his wife, will he not be considered as a sinner in the eyes of Allah? Will he not have sinned? They understood. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, likewise, if he was to fulfill his need the right way with his wife, then he will be rewarded for this. So when this concept was firmly established, that marriage is not just a transaction, but an act of worship ordained by Allah and practiced by His messengers, and a sacred act, Islam slowly began to prohibit all the wrongs that were rife in society with regards to marriage in the days of ignorance. The Quran announced, لا تجمع بين الأختين إلا ما قد صلح. You will not keep two sisters in your nikah any one time. لا تنكح ما نكح آباؤكم من النساء إلا ما قد صلح. There is no such thing as nikahi makt. There is no such thing as marrying your father's wife after his death. نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الشغار. There is no such thing as nikahi shighar. فانكحوا ما طاب لكم من النساء مثنى وثلاثة ورباع. You will restrict yourself to four maximum with the condition of equality and justice, and you will not marry more than four. You will not marry five and ten as you once did. وآتوا النساء صدقاتهن نحلة. And you will not keep the dowry. You will give them their dowry. لا تنكح الأيم حتى تستأمر ولا تنكح البكر حتى تستأذن. And you will not force them to marry somebody who they do not wish to marry. Islam began to prohibit all the wrongs that were rife in society with regards to marriage in the days of ignorance. Now, out of all the wrongs that were rife in the days of ignorance, one which still remains to this very day, and especially amongst those that have come from Pakistan, India and Bangladesh, is this one in which a man or woman who is sane and mature, has reached the age of puberty, is not consulted at the time of his marriage, and is forced into marrying somebody he or she does not wish to marry, somebody he or she dislikes. Some a blackmail, some are threatened, and some are severely beaten. And when a marriage like this takes place, what happens? 99.99% divorce. Within a matter of few days, year to the most. Sometimes the girl runs away to the social services, and Allah forbid what happens there. Sometimes he or she goes to live with the partner he or she has chosen, this time without nikah, and this time living the haram way. And the media pick up stories like this. They're waiting to pick up stories like this, and then they begin to relate this as being an Islamic problem. And as I've mentioned, their aim and objective is just to hurt Islam. Their aim and objective is just propaganda against Islam and create hatred for Islam in the hearts of the masses, Muslims and non-Muslims alike. So nobody goes towards Islam. They want to turn people away from Islam. Okay, these are the teachings of Islam. And they're always looking for opportunities like this. Yes, we agree that the issue or the problem of forced marriages exists within our societies. It's not a thing that can be denied. But one thing is for certain, it is not an Islamic problem. It is a cultural problem. It exists among Sikhs and Hindus who are non-Muslims. It exists within Pakistanis, Bengalis, Gujaratis, Punjabis, Pathans. It exists within those people that have come from Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, whether they are Muslims or whether they are non-Muslims. Islam is free from allegations made like this against Islam. Because in Islam, marriage is not seen as a transaction. It is seen as an act of worship. When you have married, you have acted upon one of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are receiving reward for it. It is a unique thing, and the thing that Islam has to offer to a bride and groom, no religion offers what Islam has to offer. The teachings of Islam are pure, and they cannot be touched. Islam teaches that those in authority cannot force those under their charge, yet in their charge, to marry somebody who they do not wish to marry. It teaches that those in charge should consult and ask permission from those who are in their charge. Listen to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this respect. The hadith narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an, that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-ayyimu ahaqqu Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, La tunkahu al-ayyim hatta tusta'mar. Wa la tunkahu al-bikr hatta tusta'zan. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that a previously married woman shall not be married till she gives consent. And a virgin shall not be married till permission is asked from her. The Sahaba asked, Ya Rasulullah, wa kayfa idhnuha? O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how will we know that she has given consent? Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam replied, An taskut. Her silence when she is asked, her silence indicates her permission. The hadith in Abu Dawud, لَيْسَ لِلْوَلِيِّ مَعَ السَّيِّبِ أَمْرٌ Exactly the same meaning. The hadith in Sahih Muslim, الْأَيِّمُ أَحَقُّ بِنَفْسِهَا مِنْ وَلِيِّهَا وَالْبِكْرُ تُسْتَأْذِرُ فِي نَفْسِهَا Yet again, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that a previously married woman is more of a guardian for herself than her guardian. And a virgin shall be asked for permission. And her silence indicates her permission. The hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala an, a father brought his daughter to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and said, Ya Rasulullah, Inna ibnati hadhihi abat an tatazawwaj. That my daughter refuses to marry. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to the girl, Ati'i abak. That listen to your father and obey your father. Listen to what she said to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. She said to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, La hatta tukhbirani ma haqqa zawj ala zawjatih. O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not till you tell me what is the right of a husband on his wife. And she repeated her words. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to her that the right of a husband is such that if he was to bleed from somewhere, and if wife was such so obeying that she licked the blood to stop the wound, to stop the blood flowing, even then she has not fulfilled his right. When she heard this from Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, thinking that she, if she marries, she will not be able to fulfill the right of her husband, she said to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَ بِالْحَقِّ لَأَتَزَوَّجُ أَبَدًا I swear by the one who has sent you with truth that I will never marry. And the part of the hadith which concerns us, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam thereupon said, لَا تَنْكِحُوهُنَّ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِنَّ That do not marry them except with their permission. The hadith in Nasai, a woman called Khansa came to our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and she complained that her father has married her to his brother's son without consulting her, and she dislikes that. She related the incident to our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, who told her to wait till Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam comes. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came, and she related the incident to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. What did Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam do? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam called her father. He called her father and he gave the girl choice whether she wants to continue or whether she wants to break off the marriage. She said, Ya Rasulullah, kad ajastu ma sana'a bi. O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my messenger of Allah, that I give permission to what my father has done. But the reason I came was because I wanted to teach the women and inform them. كَأَنَّ لَيْسَ لِلْآبَاءِ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ That with regards to this mother, with regards to this matter, parents have no choice in the matter. Meaning that they should consult their daughters before they marry them, and they should not force them to marry somebody who they do not wish to marry. The hadith in Abu Dawud, Nasai ibn Majah. A young woman came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and complained that her father has married her to somebody who she does not want to get married to. The hadith states, فَخَيَّرَهَا النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ بَيْنَ قَبُولِهِ أَوْ رَفْضِهِ Yet again, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave this woman a choice in whether she wants to continue or whether she wants to break off the marriage. And a final hadith with regards to this matter, the hadith in Sahih Muslim. Hazrat Barira radiallahu ta'ala anha was a slave girl married to a slave called Mughith. She herself was very beautiful, but Mughith not so. Now when she was freed, she had a choice in whether she wants to continue the marriage or separate. She decided to separate. Mughith loved her so much, that with tears in his eyes, he would follow Barira wherever she went. Whichever alley, whichever street, Hazrat Barira radiallahu ta'ala anhu would be walking, Hazrat Mughith would be crying, tears flowing from his eyes, and he would be following Barira wherever he goes. When Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam saw this, he said to Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Ya Abbas, ألا تعجب من حب مغيث بريرة ومن بغض بريرة مغيثا. Abbas, are you not astonished at the love Mughith has for Barira and the hatred Barira has for Mughith? When Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam saw this, he called Hazrat Barira radiallahu ta'ala anha. And he said to Hazrat Barira radiallahu ta'ala anha, لو راجعتي. Look at Mughith, he's always crying. Why don't you return to him? Listen to this. We have the Messenger of Allah talking, speaking, and we have a believer. She said to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, ta'muruni? Are you ordering me? Because if it's an order, fa'al ghasi wal ayn, then I will fulfill the order. Ya Rasulullah, ta'muruni? Are you ordering me to go back to Mughith? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the one who brought the laws of Allah, knew the law, said, I'm not ordering you. Innama ana ashfa. I'm interceding on behalf of Mughith. She said, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, if that is the case that you are not ordering me and you are just interceding, la hajat li fi, then I'm in no longer need of Mughith. And she did not go back to him. So these are the teachings of Islam. Pure teachings. Islam does not give the permission to those in charge to marry those in their charge as long as they are sane and mature. Force them to marry anyone who they do not wish to marry. Balki Islam goes a step further. And Islam says and announces, according to Fiqh Hanafi, that a woman does not need anybody to give her in marriage. She can marry herself. Though it is desirable and mustahab, preferable, that her wali, those in charge, give her in marriage. It is better that this takes place. The Fuqaya Hanafiya write in this respect that it is permissible for a woman to marry herself to somebody, marry her daughter to somebody, and even be a representative on behalf of somebody else. Having said this, if she marries outside Kuf, marries somebody that is not compatible, in these circumstances the awliya, those in charge, will have the right to object to this marriage. A woman came herself without her wali and offered herself to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Sahal ibn Sa'ad al-Sa'idi radiallahu ta'ala released that I was amongst the people when a woman came herself without her wali and she presented herself to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam in marriage. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave no answer. She stood up for a second time and presented herself in marriage to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Yet again Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave no answer. When she stood up for the third time and presented herself, one of the audience, one of the Sahaba stood up and said, Ya Rasulullah, ankihniha. Wa Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you have no need, then marry this woman to me. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam asked his Sahabi, do you have anything with you? He replied, no. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, go and find something. Walu khatam min hadith. Even if it's a ring made of iron. The Sahabi of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went and returned after a short while and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I cannot find anything. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Hal ma'aka min al-Qur'an shay? Have you memorized any part of the Qur'an off by heart? He replied, yes. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I've married her to you for what you know of the Qur'an. So these are the teachings of Islam, that a woman can marry herself to somebody without her wali, as long as she's sane and mature. But having said this, it is preferable, desirable, mustahab, that her wali gives her away. And at the same time, after having related these ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this does not give you, the audience, the green light to take these ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam home and begin to debate and argue with your mothers and fathers with regards to this matter. Because under no circumstance have I come today to convey this message. And under no circumstance is it permissible for you to argue with your mother and father. If somebody is suffering from a problem of this nature, then he should consult his local scholars and muftis, ask them the ruling, and act upon it within the limits of the Sharia. But under no circumstance should he himself argue or debate with his mother and father, because the status of one's mother and father is equal to none other. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, سَأَلْتُ النَّبِيَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَيُّ الْأَعْمَالِ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ. That I asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, out of all the deeds that one can do, which is the best deed that Allah loves most of all? He replied, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, As-salatu ala waqtiha. To read salah in its correct time is the best deed that Allah loves most of all. He said, Ya Rasulullah, summa ayyun. After salah, which is the deed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves most of all? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, after salah in its correct time, the deed that Allah loves most of all is birrul walidain. Staying in the service of your mother and father, respecting and honoring your mother and father, being dutiful and kind to your mother and father. A man came permission to ask Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam for jihad. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked him, Amin walidayka ahadun hay? Are anyone of your mother and father alive? He replied, Ummi, my mother is alive. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, then your jihad is with your mother. Meaning, go and stay with your mother, be kind and be dutiful, and you will receive the reward of jihad whilst you are in the company of your mother. When he returned to his mom, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, and what precious words, رِضَى الرَّبِّ فِي رِضَى الْوَالِدِ وَسَخَطُ الرَّبِّ فِي سَخَطِ الْوَالِدِ. That the pleasure of the Almighty lies in the pleasure of your mother and father, and the displeasure of the Almighty lies in the displeasure of your parents. Meaning that if your parents are pleased and happy with you, then think the Almighty is pleased and happy with you. And if your parents are displeased with you, then think the Almighty is displeased with you. Just to utter one word, which hurts the feelings of your mother and father, it is haram to utter one such word. If you open the book of Allah, the book of Allah says, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنَ إِحْسَانًا. Wherever he's mentioned himself, thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions parents. That Allah has ordained that you will worship none but He, and you will do good to your parents. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْحَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. That if your parents reach old age, one or both, then you will not utter one word, you will not even say the word "uff" to them, and you will not utter one word which brings pain to them or puts them into taklif and in difficulty. You will respect and honor them. The Quran goes a step further. As you are well aware, there is no sin which Allah hates more than shirk, making partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no sin which Allah detests more than shirk. To the extent that the Quran says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَٰلِكَ لَمَنْ يَشَاءُ. If Allah wishes, He will forgive any sin He wishes. He'll forgive one who drinks wine if he wishes, one who gambles if he wishes, one who commits adultery if he wishes. The Almighty, because He is Ghafoor, He is Rahim, He will forgive anything He wishes. But there's one sin that the Almighty will never, never forgive, and that is making partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran says, مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever makes partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Jannah is haram on him, he will never enter Jannah. Now bear this in mind. Now bear what the Quran says at the same time. The Quran says, وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِئْهُمَا. That if one's parents are mushrik, they don't believe in Allah, they make partners with Allah, and at the same time they force their child to commit this evil and great sin, the Quran says, فَلَا تُطِئْهُمَا. You will not listen to them in this respect. And that's the law of Allah. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوكٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. Wherever the Creator is being disobeyed, at that time there is no obedience to the creation. At the same time, the Quran says, after this the Quran still says, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Even though this is the circumstance, the Quran doesn't give us the green light to argue and debate with them. If this is the situation of our mother and father that they are forcing us, to make partners with Allah, and they themselves mushrikeen. In spite of this, the Quran still says, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. As a child, you will remember that they are your mother and father, and you will respect them, and you will love them, and you will stay in their service, and you will fulfill their rights, and you will make khidmah of them. This is the situation of one's mother and father. Now, I don't want to move away from the title that has been allocated today. But I want all those that are present here to listen to the talk either given by myself on the status of parents or by any other scholar, so that we know where we stand, so we know where to draw the line with our rights and with our mother and father's rights. What I will say is that the very same Allah who's given our mother and father such a status which is equal to none other, the very same being that has given such rights to our mother and father, the very same being has given children rights. And it is the right of the child, sane, mature, that he is not forced to marry against his will. The very same Allah has given the child this right, that he should be consulted at the time of his marriage, and as long as he's sane and mature, he should not be forced to marry against his will. And as we have seen, the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ clearly indicated. Having said this, this does not mean that my brothers and sisters go and marry any Tom, Dick and Harry, as is the case today. Any Sharabi Kababi from the street because he claims that he likes you or loves you, under no circumstance. This is the beauty about Islam. It doesn't leave the individual to take this great step all by himself. It guides the individual all the way. The guidance that Islam gives with regards to marriage, no religion offers such guidance. Let me relate a few hadiths with regards to choosing a partner. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said, تُنْكَحُ الْمَرْأَةُ لِأَرْبَعٍ لِمَالِهَا وَلِحَسَبِهَا وَجَمَالِهَا وَلِدِينِهَا فَاصْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said that a woman is married for four reasons. One of four reasons, that is generally the case, that a woman is picked. First, لِمَالِهَا, because she's loaded. You want to marry her because you want a piece of the cake. Easy life, she's a few million in the bank account. You'll never have to work. If you pick a partner like this, you can live off her wealth. So you've seen her and you want to marry her because of her wealth. That's the first reason. The second, وَلِحَسَبِهَا, because of her status and accomplishment. She's got a big post, or she's some princess, some royal, and you want to marry her because it will make you look good, the husband of some princess. You will also get a status because of her, so you marry her because of this reason. The third, وَلِجِمَالِهَا, you marry her because of her beauty. She's Miss Wonderful. And the fourth reason that a person marries a woman, وَلِدِينِهَا, because she is religious, she's practicing, she's a good Muslim. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, and listen very carefully, my young brothers and my young sisters, when you intend to get married, make sure that the first thing that you look for is deen. That she is religious, she or he is a good Muslim. She or he is practicing. They obey the laws of Allah, and they obey the laws of His Messenger, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because it is Islam that teaches this person who is religious to love you, to respect you, to honor you, to fulfill your rights as a husband or a wife. It is Islam that teaches this individual these things. Wealth, status, money, beauty do not teach these things. They will not teach the woman to love you and respect you and treat you as a husband and fulfill your rights. These qualities are not everlasting. No matter how beautiful a woman is, no matter how rich of a woman is, no matter how big of a status she's got, if she does not love you, if she does not respect you and treat you as a husband, I guarantee, if she treats you like dirt, then I guarantee within a few days, you yourself will kick her out of the house. You yourself will get rid of her. If she treats you like dirt and she does not love and respect you, it's within a few hours, a few days, you yourself will get rid of her. So the first quality that a man or a woman to marry should look for in a partner is religion and piety. There was a time that women or men, when they saw this quality in person, they themselves would present themselves to that person. A woman on seeing Nabi alayhi salatu was the hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala an, a woman on seeing Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's piety, she herself came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and said, Ya Rasulullah, alaka bi haja, are you in need of me? Would you like to marry me? When this woman left, Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu's daughter was also present at the time. She said to her father, what a shameless lady she was. Shame on her. Listen to the reply of her father. Her father said to her, Hiya khayrun mink. You're saying this regarding her, she was better than you. Raghibat fi Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She saw Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. She had a liking for Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. And she presented herself to Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam. This was the quality the young men and women of the time were looking for. Deen. Because they knew that was the key to success. To an everlasting marriage till death do us part, as they say. The fathers of the time had exactly the same mentality. When they were looking for a partner for their daughters, they were looking for a religious partner. And when they found that partner, they did not wait for that person to come to them. They themselves took their daughters and offered it to that man. The hadith in Sahih Muslim, when Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anha's daughter, Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, became a widow. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anha, on seeing Hazrat Usman radiallahu ta'ala anha's piety, himself came to Hazrat Usman and offered his daughter Hafsa to him. Hazrat Usman at the time replied, Sa'anzur fi amri, I will think about it. A few days passed. Hazrat Umar met Hazrat Usman for a second time. And Hazrat Usman informed Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anha that it's not possible for me to marry at this moment in time. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anha says, thereafter I approached Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha. He said, I said to Hazrat Abu Bakr, in shi' zawajtuk Hafsa. Oh Abu Bakr, if you wish, I will give my daughter in marriage to you. He said, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu remained quiet, he didn't answer. Hazrat Umar says, I became very angry. I was more angry with Abu Bakr than I was with Uthman because Abu Bakr didn't reply. He says, a few days and Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked my daughter's hand in marriage. When I met Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to me, Umar, perhaps you were angry when I did not reply. The reason I did not reply is because I heard Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam make a mention of your daughter. And I didn't want to spread the secret of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. If Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left your daughter, then Abu Bakr would have taken your daughter's hand in marriage. So this was the mentality with the children, and this was the mentality of the elders. That when they looked for a partner, they looked for this first quality. And what is the mentality today with our young ones? That is the last thing they consider. And our elders, the only thing they're concerned about is either chachi ka beta, pupi ka beta, and so forth. So the fault lies with both of us. Nor do the young ones, there's nothing wrong with chachi ka beta as long as the first quality that is looked for is deen. If he is deendar, he is religious, then what better than chachi ka beta? But unfortunately, nor does the young ones look for deen. They'd marry anybody. And how they get into them positions is by committing haram. And our elders also do not consider religion. There are many other attributes which one should look for, but I don't have the time, because I've already been speaking for quite a while, but I'm just going to mention a few things before I finish. You can go to your local scholars and ask them what are the attributes or qualities that one should be looking for in a husband or a wife. What I will say is, that once you've chosen a partner, the beauty about Islam is that it does not just give you permission to look at the partner, it encourages you to look. It encourages you to look, you go look at it. The hadith, a sahabi came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, and he informed Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam that he's intending to marry a certain woman from the Ansar. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said to the sahabi, "Anazarta ilayha?" Have you seen this woman that you are thinking of marrying? He replied, "No." Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, "Go have a look at her." Why? فَإِنَّ فِي أَعْيُنِ الْأَنْصَارِ شَيْئًا. Because there's something in the eyes of the Ansar. It is possible that you dislike this thing and then refuse. Go first have a look at her before you marry her. So these are the teachings of Islam. Then a step further, Islam goes that once you've decided and picked your partner, it doesn't take hours to get married. The teachings of Islam are so pure that it would take 15, 20 seconds the most to get married. Two sane, mature Muslim witnesses, male. Man says, nakahtuk. Woman says, qabiltu. The witnesses have listened to this and understood this, or words in any language which have the same meaning. In the eyes of Allah, you are married. How long did it take me to say this? 10, 15 seconds? In the eyes of Allah, you are married. Now nobody goes saying these words, because even if you're joking, in the eyes of Allah, you will be married. Likewise, divorce. A lot of people laugh and say, "I've divorced my wife. She's gone." Even if you joke. ثَلَاثٌ جِدُّهُنَّ جِدٌّ وَهَزْلُهُنَّ جِدٌّ النِّكَاحُ وَالتَّلَاقُ وَالْإِتَاقُ. Three things which you say in reality will be reality, and when you joke, they still will be reality. And those three things, النِّكَاحُ, to marry. I've said, نَكَحْتُكِ, she said, قَبِلْتُ, there were witnesses there, I'm married. Whether I was joking or whether I meant it. I've said, I've divorced her. Whether I was joking or whether I was serious, she's gone. And freeing a slave, I said, you're free. Whether I was joking or whether I meant it, it's gone. So these are the beautiful teachings of Islam. And the second thing that Islam teaches is that this woman, this act that you have performed is a sacred act. And this woman that you have chosen to become your bride, you cannot have her for free. Because in the eyes of Allah, this act that you have performed has a value. You will have to give a present to this woman. And this present in Islam is called mahar, is known as dowry. وَآتُ النِّسَى صَدُقَاتِهِنَّ نِحْلًا. The least limit of which is 10 dirhams, according to Fiqh Hanafi, and the maximum, there is no limit. In the days of Umar, the women began to ask for a lot of dowry. As Umar radiallahu ta'ala gave khutbah, stopping women from doing such a thing. He delivered the khutbah. He descended after giving the khutbah, and an old woman stood and said, "Umar, what you have said, is that more worthy of following or what the Quran says?" He asked, "Obviously what the Quran says. What do you mean by this?" He said, "The Quran says, وَآتَيْتُمْ إِحْدَاهُنَّ قِنْطَارٌ فَلَا تَأْخُذُ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا." Umar, you say this, the Quran says if you give him a qintar, a very large amount, even then you cannot take anything from her. Subhanallah, Umar radiallahu ta'ala replied, "Kullu ahadin aqqa min Umar." Everybody is more clever and knowledgeable than Umar. Umar climbed the minbar for a second time and rectified his mistake in front of all the audience. Having said this, this does not mean that our sisters begin to ask for a big dowry. Because Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, "Inna a'zama an-nisa'i barakatan aysaruhunna ma'unatan aysaruhunna sadaqatan." That the best of all nikahs is one in which the mahar, this present and this dowry, was less. Because the problem that we have in the Middle Eastern countries is the problem of dowry. The women are asking for ridiculous amounts, 100,000 riyals. And bichara, our brothers, because they cannot afford such an amount, this, without a doubt, leads one to commit sin if he's unable to marry. So the best nikah is one in which the mahar was not too much. And finally, the Islam says that now that you have married, Islam encourages you to go celebrate this marriage. And this celebration is called walima. Now this does not mean that you take out 10,000 loan and hire the biggest of all holes, one bigger than your neighbor did or your relative did, and the latest limousines and BMs or Mercs and musicians and the works. 99% of things that take place in our marriages are haram. And it is not even sunnah to attend a marriage like that, in which all the laws of Allah are broken. The best walima is the one which is the most simplest. When the best of all creations got married with our mother, Hazrat Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha, he invited the Muslims for his walima. And what did we find on the dastarkhan? There was no chicken, no meat. There were dates, yogurt, dried yogurt, and butter. This was the walima of the best of all creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me the tawfiq to act upon what I have said. And Allah gave you the tawfiq to act upon what I have said. If there is something that has been misunderstood by any of you from what I've said today, then go back to your scholars and ask them to explain in detail. I'm sure they would be more than happy to do such a thing. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.